Okay. Okay, 501, thanks for joining. Sorry, I was running a little late there. So this is LDR 340, week 8. So the last Zoom session in the last week that we'll share. So thanks for hanging in there, making it this far. I hope you had a little fun with this course. I know I did. Fascinating to watch and read what you all come up with. And it's interesting to see how multiple people can read the same thing and find different pieces to pull out. Not everybody always has the same outlook. With that, I think everybody did a decent job of identifying the crux issue. We, you know, kind of had to work our way through it a little bit and understand what the purpose of this course was, which is we find the protagonist to be able to go in there and then be able to identify what he or she is doing or has done or should be doing. And then reaching back in LDR 300 and pulling in those leadership principles, models, theories, techniques, and the like. All right. Now, I'd hope that carries over into your paper. Okay. Again, you know, this works if you personalize the case that you're looking at. Hence the reason why I kept after you to find the protagonist, because that's where we'll find the leadership issues. Remember, the CEO, the commanding officer, the boss is responsible for everything that the organization does or fails to do. In the end, it's a leadership issue in most cases, and then we just need to find those. Again, you know, cause and effect plays into this a little bit. So what we got to do is find the problem. What is the cause of what we're seeing? So if, for example, we were looking at a leadership case study of, say, Samsung, when they had their phones blowing up and catching fire, then an effect of the leadership issue is, in fact, the fire of the phones. Okay, the fire on the phones is not the problem that we are trying to address. Okay, we're not an engineering class. We're not a sales marketing class. Okay, now, to be sure, a phone catching fire is a problem. But what we're trying to get at is what were the leadership challenges or problems inherent? And so, in the case of the Samsung fire, we learned that the boss was allowing the phones to leave the factory without anybody doing a serious quality control on the batteries. And in fact, the batteries were being made by a different firm. So it wasn't even Samsung's batteries per se. However, that's going to be tough to explain to a customer, isn't it? So the problem in this case is that the CEO was allowing the customer to be your quality control check. And that's not a good idea. All right. So just an example. All right. You should all have done your leadership coach. If you have not, that's going to be a little bit of a challenge when you take the final. And that was one of the requirements, and ultimately it was something that was designed to help you. Okay, so in my welcome announcement that I sent out way back in October, if you could believe that, I laid it out for you on the online tutorial. Okay, this is highlighted now on your screen. And the whole idea here was to make sure you all had every opportunity to succeed. Okay, while you're looking at that screen, I'm gonna pull up on Zoom here and make sure this is broadcasting out. So bear with me just one second. Thank you. Okay. So it looks like we got in there. All right. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and leave. All right. So what are we talking about here? All right, the online tutorial, Case Analysis Coach, was Harvard Business Publishing. All right, and there's a link that I provided to you in the welcome announcement. I have to be honest, and I apologize to you, in my notification this last week, the initial link I put in there did not work. Thank you to one of your fellow students, Mr. Sam Underwood, for finding that out for me. I've corrected it. Okay, the link should take you right there. But again, we shouldn't have been waiting until the night that I've recommended to you to have this done. Although in the end, if you are having trouble accessing the materials, then you've got to contact HBP, Harvard Business Publishing, because it's their internet site and I have no control over that. All right, not a cop-out, just a statement of fact. Okay, so in the welcome announcements, every week, from the welcome initial to the week one assignment instructions, let's pull that up real fast. You will see that I've told you to work it on your own time, and that you should have it done by tonight, 23:59. So there's still some time for those of you who haven't got it. Quite frankly, I know who didn't have it, because I can go into Harvard Business Publishing and find out who didn't. You'll note that that's not technically a grade point. This is a requirement of the syllabus, and I'm assuming that you got it. And if you're not gonna use it, then that is on you. But anyway, all the way in through the weeks, this is the link, okay? So click on the link, and it will take you to you'll see a screen that looks like this. Okay, you then go in and log in and register. Okay, and then you should be able to get it without any issues. All right. Okay, so in the end, if you've chosen not to take it, I'm not going to penalize you for that, even though that is a requirement. With that said, there are four questions on the final exam that's opening tomorrow that relate to the tutorial. So either good luck on the exam, or I suggest you take the tutorial, all right? A tutorial gives you detail what's been covered. And I've given you an attachment on this email that tells you what the tutorial does. And there's some great information in there that helps round out your text. Okay? All right, well, enough of that. Again, these notices are the same. Moodle will be offline on Monday, the 16th of December, between 1900 and 2300 Eastern Standard. Eastern Standard. And the technology services and sports from the University of Mount Olive will be migrating your email account off of mock.edu to umo.edu, and that's going to take place on Thursday, December 19th. So in there, I'm going to be posting your final grades. And predominantly, I'll be emailing out to you feedback from your papers. Good job on your papers so far. Two of you have already turned them in, which is phenomenal. And I will be grading those straight away. All right. So let's take a look here. I'm scrolling down now on the Moodle page. Here we are, week 8. In each of these, I've told you, make sure to read the assignment instructions, if you would. And that should tell you everything you need to know, so there'd be no last-minute surprises. All right. There are two exams in this course. So the final exam is going to open up at noon on Wednesday, tomorrow, the 11th. It is the 10th on my board. And sorry, I needed to check that email real fast. Okay, and it is virtually identical to your midterm in that it is a series of true-false followed by best answer, not multiple guess, not multiple choice, but best answer. The material in the final will cover your text, chapters 8 through 11. So the final is not comprehensive. It will cover those chapters that you've read since the midterm. All right. There will be 4 questions from the online tutorial. There is a time limit, and there's no questions on any of the cases that that we've discussed. So no questions on, for example, the instructor articles. That said, there is a question, just like on the midterm, that if you haven't been reading my feedback, then you're going to have a hard time with it. So hopefully you've been reading the feedback that I've been providing. Time limit on each quiz of 1 hour. You only get one attempt. So make sure that you're ready to take the quiz. You won't be interrupted. Be in an area that interruptions will be minimized. You may use your course materials. You may use your text. You may use the feedback that I've sent you. That said, you may not use each other. So this is not something where you collaborate with your fellow student. Okay. I want you to complete the exam no later than 1500, 3 p.m. on Saturday the 14th. Okay, so if it takes an hour to take the exam, don't start the exam at 2:45 because you're not going to have enough time unless you can take that exam 15 minutes. Some of you have tried. I'm not convinced you can, okay, and get the result that you want. So make sure that you start the exam in enough time to finish the exam before 1500. So my recommendation is you start it at least an hour before 3 o'clock, okay? The exam will automatically close, and what you've submitted is, and what you've recorded is what you'll get, okay? The last thing you'll have to do is your leadership case study paper, and that will be due no later than 23:59 or 11:59, Saturday, the 15th of December, okay? I'm sorry, I said Saturday. I meant Sunday. I apologize. 23:59, Sunday. 15 December, okay? And then once you've got that done, please don't forget at the bottom here, on Moodle, you have an end of course survey. You'll see a link called Smart Evals. If you scroll to the top of your Moodle page, in that upper right-hand corner, you'll see that your cursor highlights a link that takes you to the course evaluations. Please take the evaluation. I assure you the dean reads each and every one. The instructors don't get to see them until the dean decides to share those with us. Everything's game on the survey, from the way the course was taught to how it's laid out to the text. I would ask that if this was an issue that you have personal with the instructor, i.e. me, that you've talked to me about it. We've had an opportunity to at least work through it, okay? Just like I know you periodically like to know how you're doing in the course, you know, so that the end grade is not a surprise. Same thing with your instructors as it relates to SMART evals. I'm an adult, okay? Feel free to talk to me like an adult. And if there's an issue again, no question, I'd like to know about it. So at least have the opportunity to address it, okay? And hopefully you did that. Otherwise, you know, that's a little bit tough to go 8 weeks through a course with an instructor and that you've got a problem with and you haven't had a result. So just kind of think of it as how you would like to be evaluated if the roles were reversed, okay? All right, enough said about that. So let's go ahead and take a look at some of the slides that I've brought in here. Okay, so first, how you present your arguments is really important. And this is something that the course is trying to get at for you. And that is to say, it's not enough to be able to go into a case study and pull out and identify the compelling issues, but you've also got to be able to get it out to your reader and be able to effectively impart your observations, your knowledge, your conclusion to your reader, to your subordinate or whomever. So that's why I think there's a great book out there. It's called Thank You for Arguing. It's a lost art form. A lot of people think argumentation is bad. It is not. It's argumentation is not unlike conflict. Okay, conflict is inevitable. Combat is a choice. Conflict can be useful, okay? And there's always going to be forms of conflict. It's how we address it and how we work through it that makes the difference, okay? And same thing with argumentation, right? You and I may have different positions on an issue, okay? And it's, of late, seems to be a lost art form because any type of dialogue between two opposing factions in this nation, it seems to distill into yelling and name calling. It's sad to see. We can have a debate, and yet it seems that a lot of people don't want to do that. Certainly, anonymous comment on internet has become in its own self a monster. So the idea here is one of the things, the reason that book is so good, again, Thank You for Arguing, is it goes through some of the logic of argumentation. So the graphic I show here of St. Thomas Aquinas is before refuting your argument, he'll take a moment to rephrase your argument to show he understands it better than you do. In other words, when I was in a course, my undergraduate course included effective speaking, okay? Not saying I did well in the course, but learned a lot. We used Dale Carnegie's text, our book as a text. But in that public speaking class, there were times where we would be matched up one-on-one and have to go through a debate. And in that, before I could state my position, I had to state with accuracy my opponent's position on whatever the issue was. And, you know, we didn't always get the position we wanted. You know, sometimes we had to argue against something we believed seriously. Okay, but the idea there was to respect your opponent and to be able to win him or her over based on the soundness of your argument and not your ability to shout over him or her or beat them into submission with ad hominem attacks and assaults on their character and and on their Linux, okay? So one of those techniques, as say, Thomas Aquinas used, is listen carefully to the position of your opponent, be able to state what that position is, and then address it, okay? And then we give you the four agreements by Don Miguel Ruiz. Impeccable with your word. Don't take it personal. Don't make assumptions, and always do your best. And I think these are some very good agreements that we should have with each hour, with each other. I love that D under number one, impeccable with your word. Use the power of your word in the direction of truth and love. I love it. Okay. So next is, again, the final exam. Timed in one shot. Don't get interrupted. There's plenty of time unless you haven't done the reading, unless you haven't paid attention. There's going to be some challenges there for you. Okay, 10 true false, 10 best answer. Again, looking for the best answer. No tricks. No multiple guess. No partial credit. Okay, again, it's going to cover chapter 7 through 11. Some of the feedback that I've given you. But no, none of the case studies, and not possibly there are four questions from the case study coach. Okay. Open book, open note, not open neighbor. So easy day. I think we'll do fine. All right. Leadership case study. Again, a couple of you there have already got yours in. Good job. The rest of you, I'm assuming, are working hard on it. And that company or organization that you're writing on is there on the right. Nobody's come in that I know of that is demanding a change. So everybody should be working on that. Okay. All right. And then don't forget your position statement. Again, I've gone over some of this with you before. Okay, it's your position statement, is your thesis. It's telling your reader what to expect out of your paper. It's up front, it's in that first paragraph. If you've done an abstract, then that position statement is in your abstract. And remember, an abstract is a concise summary of what you've written, not what you are going to write. Okay, again, don't say in an abstract, I'm going to cover this, and then I think I'll work on that, and then you may find me covering this subject. No. You state in the abstract your conclusions, what you said in the paper. Okay, you just do it in a more concise manner. In the aspect of a position statement, since you looked at the requirement of the paper and saw the questions that I was asking you address, it really does come down to an evaluation, doesn't it? And so your position statement is going to be one of an evaluation. Okay, is, and then you would have in there, instead of question mark, this would be your protagonist, okay? Him or her. All right. And effective leader. All right. So the position statement then would say, him, yes, he is, she is, or is not, right? Is your statement. Okay. Now, this can also be written as part of the organization, okay? So let's take, for example, you wrote on UPS, okay? Your position statement would be UPS is not being effectively led. And then, of course, you have because, I don't know if you remember, because symbol is your three dots almost in a triangular design. Okay, because, and remember, your evidence, right? Okay. In an evaluation, this is your criteria. This is what you have used as proof to make that statement, okay? And that's all this is. That's all the position statement is. UPS is not being effectively led because of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or however many there is. Okay, your book says 4 to 5. You know, I, as your instructor, tend to go for 3 to 5, okay? Now, in the questions that I ask you of a paper, I actually give you the criteria. There's 4 of them, right? Leadership styles, organizational structure, or structures, right? Culture, right? So I've already given you almost all of them. Okay, rest is for you to put it together, okay? But again, think of your position statement as a clear, strong, easy to read statement that tells me exactly what you're arguing, okay? It needs to be sharply focused, okay? And this is identical. A thesis statement is simply what you plan to argue plus how you plan to argue. That's identical to a position statement. Okay, in the text for this course, the author says a position statement is your conclusion plus the evidence you're going to use to support that conclusion, all right? So as we go through it, this is why I've had you go after a protagonist, because it makes it more clear who we are talking about, okay? An entity, a corporation, yes, legally can be found to be a person, but is not a person, right? In the crux of leadership, the company doesn't lead anything, okay? They is so nebulous, I don't know who we're talking about, okay? Neck it down to one person. Make it the CEO if you have to. And then go on from there. He or she is or is not an effective leader, okay? That's taking a position. She's not an effective leader because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? All right, enough of that. I think, you know, it's like that old saying, don't want to beat a dead horse, okay? And that's obviously a metaphor. We're not out assaulting horses. All right. So in an example, remember a while back we had a case study on the CEO of public broadcasting system, Ms. Paula Kirker. And in that, we made it an evaluation, okay? Did you take a position in your paper? Did you find that she is or is not an effective leader? Most of you said she is an effective leader, okay? To which I agree, I think the same thing. So how do we know she is an effective leader? Well, because we found out certain things, certain quotes out of the article, we just kind of lay them out, all right? We find out that the reporter says she steered the PBS through the digital era. We find out she had to cancel 2 popular talk shows after the individuals in charge of those shows were alleged to have committed sexual harassment. She was ready with an answer when asked, what is your explainer at a cocktail party? Which is in and of itself being asked to give an elevator pitch. Okay, give a short 2 to 3 minute blurb on your organization and why somebody should donate to it. That's what a leader does. She talks about Ken Burns, a very famous historian, and the way he works. She indicates that however he works, that the expectation is that the people that supply work to PBS will abide by the same values and principles of PBS. That's a pretty strong statement. Okay? Quote, you do have certain assumptions about how your organization works and how people within it behave. We've since looked at our practices and the way we deal with our producers to make sure everybody understands we expect people how to operate. Okay, so that's culture. That's let people know. That's moral leadership, right? Do we have any question in our mind that PBS probably has a code of ethics? I don't think we have a question. We would be assuredly no, and we realize that CEO is saying we make sure people abide by our code of ethics. Not only do they know it, but they are fully expected to operate under. And that includes people that may not, quote unquote, work for PBS, but are contributors to it in the form of shows and love, okay? And then finally, you would have cleared through that article that she is personifying the female leader that LDR 300 DAF text, okay? Remember our famous DAF text, right? As to what a female leader is, okay? Female leaders rated as having more idealized influence, more inspirational motivation, more individual and considerate, and offering more intellectual stimulation. So these are things we were finding to support our position. So then once you've done that, we've got to figure this out and put it into a one sentence statement. So we've got to not repeat verbatim what we read, but to be able to recraft it in a way that exercises brevity and gets our point across with a minimum amount of words. Okay. And so in this case, you will see I've gone in and I've color-coded it out. So what is our position? Well, I've highlighted that in blue. Right? And she is an effective leader. And then down here at the bottom of the screen, she's an effective leader due to the fact of, okay, well, let's just kind of code it out like a traffic signal light. All right. I like the fact she steered the public broadcaster in the digital era. Right. So I highlighted that in red. I like the fact that she had a ready answer and highlighted yellow. And I like the fact that she made sure everybody understands how the organization works and how they should behave. Okay, so then those just get pulled right down into our sentence. So blue, PBS CEO, Ms. Paula Kerger, is an effective leader. Okay, because, or in this case I said due to the fact, she demonstrates the qualities I identified in LDR 300 DAF text. That she has a vision, is able to implement it, right? Okay, if she steered the public broadcaster in a digital era, then she has assuredly a vision and the ability to implement that vision, okay? And that's effective leadership. She can explain and communicate her organization's mission with efficiency, okay? And this is critical. This is why you always want to know what the mission of your organization is. This is why your mission statement is so critical. Because that is enduring. That is what your organization is. All right? And it is very difficult to lead something if you don't know what it is. And what gets a lot of people in trouble, you've heard this before as it relates maybe to the military, is when they get into mission creep. They get outside of the things that their mission statement calls for. Okay? And then she knows her organizational culture and she enforces a code of ethics. So I've compiled about 5 or 7 pieces of evidence that support my position that she's an effective leader, okay? And I'll put it there in one sentence. Okay, I hope you all have the opportunity to really look at this and do it, okay? Because this is really important. Any paper that you submit should have a position statement. Make it easy for your reader. Tell your reader up front, this is my position and here's how I'm supporting. All right. Okay, we talked about beating a dead horse. That's a metaphor, not unlike the monkey that I shared with you last week. Okay. Metaphor is a figure of speech, makes an implicit, implied, or hidden comparison between two things that are unrelated but share some common characteristics. Okay. So we go through those, and there's any number of examples out there of metaphors. The key thing on a metaphor is it's a very effective tool for leaders because it helps clarify and illuminate the point that you're making. And if the people have never heard of the metaphor, they don't even know what a horse is or why you would even beat one, okay, then that's not going to be effective, okay? So, you know, people have to be familiar with it. There's a, you know, a funny or a very intriguing Star Trek episode, Star Trek The Next Generation, with Patrick Stewart, where he is with an alien, and the alien race speaks in metaphors. Well, you have to understand the metaphor to get the point, okay? But if everybody understands, then it becomes a very effective tool. Try to learn. Okay, with that, an aphorism is a pithy observation that contains a general truth. Again, it's a terse saying that expresses a principle or an observation, then it's written in a memorable form, okay? So when we talk about crowdsourcing, when we talk about open innovation as an example, we're talking about, you know, when we're sharing our ideas with others, or if we're making sure we're developing our subordinates, then the aphorism is a rising tide lifts all boats. In other words, if I've elevated everybody in this organization, then everybody in this organization is going to do better. Okay? If I seek the high ground, then everybody is going to be better off. All right, and then the rule of three, which is the tricolon. Talked about that before. It's just a form of rhetoric. It's in how you write, how you present. Okay, it's the rule of three. It's a minimum, you know, tall, dark, and handsome, calm, cool, and collected. Every Tom, Dick, and Harry, the good, the bad, and the ugly. In other words, these are all very, very common. Okay. There, an example of what I think it would have been President Barack Obama's first inauguration address. I think it's either first or second. I have to go back and look. But he used like about 20 different examples of tree colognes. Okay. All right. Just something to consider. Okay. So we're coming up on 40 minutes. And that's about all we want, but I want to go ahead and show you again, kind of for last time, the organizational success in one slide. In other words, I try to capture your leadership experience at the University of Mount Olive in just one slide, okay? So here's 2 years of coursework, or four, however long it takes. Excuse me. That an organization's success is going to depend on 7 very simple concepts. 7 who's and how's, okay? 3 who's, 4 how's, okay? And it's really that simple, all right? The critical pieces and the details, obviously. But get any one of the above wrong, any one of the 7, and you're going to be in trouble, okay? Get a lot of them wrong, and your organization's going to self-destruct. It won't exist. Okay, so what are those 7? Who to recruit, or who to hire, who to promote, who to make senior leadership, okay? How does your organization organize structures? How do you equip your people to do their jobs? How do you train your people to do their jobs? And how do your people execute the mission? Execute what it is your company does. Okay, and that's it, all right? If you are a fast food service, then, and you are recruiting the wrong, hiring the wrong people, you're going to have a problem, okay? If you don't even take the time to train them to do the job, if you haven't given them equipment to do the job, if you can't get the hamburger out in a fast, you know, couple minutes, whatever the standard is these days, you're not going to be in business. Nobody's going to want your product. Okay, and that's not a great example, but I think it clarifies it enough. So just something to take with you, because as you go through your leadership experience and as you're going through your case study analysis. If you keep that in the back of your mind, you're always going to have something to draw back on, okay? Hey, this organization doesn't sound like it is organized the right way. You know, why are these people coming in and seeing the senior leadership through an open door policy, okay? Because that may work depending on the organization. However, if you're an organization that, and you as a senior leader, thrive on organizational structure and chain of command, then an open door policy is counterproductive, okay? And again, this was a point I was trying to make for y'all with the issue of Lyft, okay? The CFO, it was great. He was bringing people in. Okay, that does seem to improve communication, but there's a cost to it, or a potential cost. It may work in that organization, but think of, you know, the framework, and he's got to be very careful in what he allows to be discussed in there, because if this is your subordinate that's going straight to the boss and not talking to you, how are you going to feel about that? Okay. And I know I wouldn't be very happy because, quite frankly, you know, if my job is middle management or as a mid-grade leader, then, you know, that's my responsibility. This is something that works for me. You know, if the person is getting all their direction from the CFO, then what am I here for? So just something to be, to consider, okay? All right. And then, okay. We didn't cover it much in this class, but when you go on to LDR 360, you're going to find a framework in which you're going to need to do what's called an environmental analysis. Okay, and when we talk environmental analysis, we're not talking how green your company is and whether or not you're allowing plastic straws in your organization. The environment in this regard is captured under the term SWOT, okay? S-W-O-T, SWOT, strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Excuse me. And so internal origin would be those strengths and weaknesses we have as an organization. So what are our strengths? What are our weaknesses? And obviously, we're going to want to maintain our strengths as compared to our competitors. And we're going to want to reduce our weaknesses. Okay, in the external realm, opportunities and threats. In other words, what are things that we can go after that will help us? And what are some of the things that we've got to avoid or lessen or somehow mitigate because they may cause a problem for us, okay? And then it comes down into how you calculate these out. Okay, so the criteria, just like in a decision or an evaluation analysis, as you learned in the text for this class, is critical. Then the criteria is very critical in your environmental analysis. Okay, and how you measure that, how you calculate that, becomes a very interesting dynamic, okay? And there's ways of doing it. And this is just one example. This is a template that I used when I was going through my master's degree level work that I thought was really good. One of the case studies we had to do was on Herman Miller, which is an office furniture supply manufacturer, iconic. If you think of who invented, for example, open office, okay? Herman Miller are the ones that invented the cubicle. Anyway, this is what we're talking about. So I just leave this with you to bat around, take a look at, find out more about, and then use this as part of your case study as you're trying to develop out your action plan, because ultimately we're trying to make the organization better, right? So having a feel for organizational and leadership strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats. And this even goes down into the individual, all right? What are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? What are opportunities out there for you? And what are some of the threats? Okay. All right, I'm going to end this show. I'm going to show a short video that's just kind of fun. And then we'll close her down, okay?
Refreshingly smooth Bud Light. Always worth it. For some of the upper bus.
Anyway. Okay. So I really like that. And I hope you did too. Okay. Well, listen. Thanks again, everybody. And I appreciate your time and effort. I wish you the best in your leadership journey. I look forward to reading case studies about you. I know these will be great stories. They won't be problems, right? And if you get the notion, you know, drop a line from time to time. Let me know how you're doing and what you think you might like me to share with whatever my current class students are, things that you found. And I'd appreciate that, okay? In the meantime, let's get those final papers in. Good luck on the final exam. And let's get this in and hope everybody has an enjoyable Christmas.